I was just very fortunate. I, for all intents and purposes, I stumbled into what I do. Growing up, I grew up in New York City, and like most kids, I liked movies, but never had any imagination that it was something that you could pursue as a career or as a life. It just, in my world, it wasn't something that people did. It was something people did in Hollywood, which for all intents was a million miles away from where I was at the time, certainly. I was more concerned with sports as a kid, actually. But, you know, we went to the movies, loved movies and all of that. And it was only while I was in college, I took a film class, and something triggered in me that you could look at films a little bit more intellectually, maybe, or artistically than we had up until that time. And I started to get work as a production assistant, and worked on camera crews as an assistant cameraman. I was for 12 years an assistant cameraman in New York, and gradually moved up through the ranks. I couldn't give any better description than to say it was just one foot in front of the other. Ultimately, as I get into it, and I felt that I enjoyed it very much and had some interest and some proclivity for cinematography, I set my sights on that and just always knew that at some point I wanted to be a cinematographer. I had no real idea about how to get there except just one foot in front of the other and try to take advantage of whatever opportunities came forward, and to study and pay strict attention for the cinematographers whom I was working for as an assistant. And it all just sort of unraveled like that. Shot lots of student films and low budget, no budget films that thank God are lost to history. And eventually got a break with a friend on a feature film called Federal Hill, which was the first feature that was released to theaters and really had any sort of notice and put me a little bit on the map. The first time I walked onto a set, it was a commercial set, and I saw a Mitchell camera, a big old Mitchell BNC sitting on a dolly. And something about it hooked me almost in that moment that I should give this pursuit a little bit of time. I was very young. I was still in school. And something clicked and told me, you know, this is interesting. Let me explore a little bit. And then that's how it began. I wouldn't say that any moment ever struck me as where I felt, oh, I've arrived, or I've suddenly reached what I attained to. I still don't feel that way. I feel I still have a long road to pursue, a long way to go to improve and grow before I'll get to anywhere that I might consider myself satisfied. The atmosphere, I think, is very similar. You know, you've got a group of people, a large group of people working together towards a common end. In terms of time and things like that, television, generally, you have to do much more in a very much shorter period of time than on a feature film. But I've also done small feature films where we had a lot to do in a very short schedule. So coming up through the low budget ranks was actually a very good thing and a very good education and a good help and training to do TV work and other things like that. And you learn to improvise and be very quick on your feet, and you really learn your craft in that way. American Buffalo was a very interesting experience. It was with the same director of Federal Hill, Michael Corrente, who I've known for, my God, since the mid 80s, and when we were both coming up together. In fact, separate issue, we shot a pilot together this spring. Well, I'll tell you maybe more about that later. But American Buffalo, it was a big jump from Federal Hill, in which we made for virtually no money, to a film with major movie stars, Dustin Hoffman, and a major television star, Dennis Franz, from a very highly acclaimed play by David Mamet. It was very interesting because the film is pretty much limited to one location. And it's a course of events that happen over a day And the trick was to keep things interesting. Give the actors space to act, because that, above all, is what the show is about. It all has to be related through the actors and the writing. And give them room to work on the set and not nail them down to specific marks or specific positions that would tend, I think, to inhibit the actors in that situation. So it was somewhat of a broader lighting plan that I might like personally or might employ today. But at the time, I believe it really did fit the material. And we did the best that we could to keep it from not feeling like a filmed play, to have it have a little bit more cinematic feel to it than might seem on the surface. I'm pleased with it. I mean, you know, I always say that I wish I could go back and reshoot everything I've ever done, going back to day one. I just finished a small project in Georgia a week ago, and I wish I could go back and reshoot it now. I think it's just the nature of who we are and what we do. We're always striving to improve. I haven't seen American Buffalo in quite some time, but if it turns up on TV or somebody wants to watch it, I'll look at it for a little bit, a few minutes. And I look at it and you come to a peace, I think, an appeasement. You come to an agreement with your past self. And I look at it and I'm very pleased with it. I would reshoot it entirely if I was able to, but that's never going to happen. And looking at who I was in my development as a cinematographer at that time, which was 1995, I think, looking at that, looking at the time, the schedule, the people, the crew, all of the elements, I think we did about as best. I always feel that I leave my best on the field. You know, I do my best with what we've got, no matter what. So you have to, at a certain point, sort of like set it free. You know, I've done everything I possibly can, using all of my experience and all of my knowledge, and everything that I have to this moment is there as best as I could apply it. And now I set it free. And if people like it, great. If they don't, I can live with it. You know, it's okay. But I'm overall pleased. Yes, I think it holds up. Well, I think the challenges are pretty much the same, you know. As an artist, you're trying to get inside the director's head and see how they want to interpret the material. There can only be one director on a film, and we follow that person's lead. Directors will often give you varying degrees of freedom as a cinematographer in terms of staging or lighting. Some have very specific ideas about one or the other or both. Others would rather pay more attention to the actors and the performance and leave a little bit more of the staging and what have you to the cinematographer. Either way, your job is to not make your own movie, but to take the director's intent and make that your own and bring something of yourself to that. So that's always a challenge. And it's a fun challenge. That's why what I find so fascinating about cinematography. The other challenges are the mechanics of what we do. You know, how do you break down the script and figure out mechanically how you will execute certain things? Dealing with schedules, long and short. It always seems these days that we're trying to do too much work in too short a period of time. So you have to be very clever and very malleable and fluid in how you approach these things so you can leave some room for spontaneous creativity, things like that. And those changes, those challenges have always been there for all cinematographers, and they probably always will. It's just the nature of what we do. You know, I take my cues from the script. I may have an idea myself about a certain approach or a certain aspect of a film or a television project. But again, it goes back to the director's intent. And over time, preparation during the prep period, many, many hours of conversation, perhaps looking at other films or photographs or whatever references might be appropriate. I feel that by the time we start to shoot, I come with a a deep understanding of how the director sees the material. So then it becomes my job to interpret that in physical terms, to make it reality from words on a page to reality, physical reality that other people can share and see. And somewhere in that process is what I try to add of myself, where things that almost cannot be put into words. I mean, so much of what cinematographers do exists in the land of, it just feels right, you know? It just feels right. Something meshes, something within you agrees with what the result of what you're seeing or what you're aiming to do. And as often as you can feel that it's right, you can just as easily feel that it's not right. Very often I can frame something up or light something or stage something and watch it and just feel that something's not right. And it's an indescribable thing in the pit of my chest. And I've spoken to other cameramen and cinematographers about this, and everyone agrees. We all have that same thing. And you'll take steps to correct it. But when it's right, you know when it's right as well. And I think that is part of the personal aspect of what we put into what we do. You know, it always fascinates me that what we do is essentially we freeze a moment in time so that other people might share it at another time. And I've always found that fascinating and romantic on some level, and endlessly interesting. So it's always a challenge of trying to balance those factors and serve the project, serve the director, and serve your inner impulses in such a way that they all meld into one piece that hopefully works for everyone. It was a lot of fun to do. It was a lot of fun to make. Chris Weitz and Paul Weitz, it was their first film. And we had a substantial budget, but it wasn't one of Universal's giant budgets of that year. So we were pretty much left to our own devices while making the movie. And the movie itself reflects that. I think there's a youthful exuberance about it. And it reflects the experience of making the film, where we had a lot of fun. It was the funniest script I've ever read by far. And I think most of that feeling ends up on the screen. I think the movie, I saw a piece of it recently, and after not seeing it for quite some time, and I really do believe that it held up well. It's one of those movies that is common to almost everyone's experience. Everyone has been a teenager at an awkward stage and had those concerns and gone through those phases to one extent or another. So everyone recognizes it and recalls it in their life, and it's almost a universal theme. So when I see it, it brings back very good memories, and it was a very, very enjoyable experience. Well, in terms of dealing with actors, as a cinematographer, I just try to stay out of their way. Actors have an incredibly, incredibly difficult job. And the more I do my job and get a chance to watch them up close, is the more I really appreciate what they do. I don't have a drop of that in my body. So I admire it when I see other people doing it so well. So I just try to create a calm, safe, welcoming environment for the actors in which they can feel relaxed and feel free to do what they need to do. And I just try to stay out of their way. You know, I try to light in a very unobtrusive way, to give them freedom to do what they need to do and feel natural in their environment, not that they're being put on by a lot of technology. Occasionally that's unavoidable, but in general, we try to keep it that way. I am friendly, but not familiar. As I say, I generally try not to engage because I know that there's a great deal of concentration that actors must maintain to carry on what they do. So I try not to break that. If an actor will reach out or make a first overture, I'd be very happy to chat or speak. But generally speaking, I try to keep out of their way and give them as much space as possible and as much quiet and peace. I try to maintain my crew to have everyone stay quiet on set. I can't stand when sets get too loud and boisterous as if it's a party going on. It's hard enough to do the work as it is, but with all those distractions, it's not good. And it's even worse for the actors. So it's good to give them a place where they can feel safe and free and open and easy to do what they need to do. Oh my goodness. Some of the best moments of my career. You know, there have been so many, and I often get asked this question, and it's so difficult to pin one in particular. One of the great moments happened in my kitchen at home when I opened my, on December 10th of 1999, when I opened my letter of invitation to the ASC. That was one of the great moments, not actually shooting, but related to shooting. On set moments, there have been so many, and I enjoy so many aspects of what we do that it's very hard to isolate one or two or 10 in particular. It's just every day, new experiences, lots of interesting, energetic, motivated people, interesting location or set. You never face the same thing twice, even if you've done it 1,000 times, 1,000,000 times, it's never twice the same way. That's always good, and it's always stimulating, and it's always fun to me because of that. You never learn everything. Every job, every day, you learn something new. You pick up some little thing that you never noticed before. You improve on a certain level if you have the right mindset. That's what I recall most of all. There have been many great moments with the individuals I've worked with, and many satisfying moments of seeing something come to life that you've lit with real people now walking through space and bringing it to life. That's always exciting. And I could pick any of hundreds of examples, but one in particular doesn't exactly stand out. There have been too many good ones to pick one in particular. Outside of work, I consider work my hobby to a great extent. Work is always integrated into life. You know, you're watching films, you're watching things on television, taking photographs, meeting with colleagues, all of that. If I have any hobby to be spoken of, it would be Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. And I spend a lot of time pursuing that in my free time. And I do that with the same passion that I have for working as a cinematographer. It's just a beautiful, different pursuit to be passionate about, because while you're doing that, you can't think of anything else except what you're doing. So it's a mind cleanse. But in terms of hobbies, I really look at work, just cinematography, as the greatest gift. You know, here in Los Angeles today, it's a very interesting day outside because we're going to get some rain, and clouds are coming through, and there are patches where the sun comes through. And I was out to meet someone earlier for breakfast, and just driving and walking through the streets and seeing the changes, the active changes in light right before your eyes, the grandness of it all, from the sky, from the heavens, the sun and the clouds. It's inspiring as a cinematographer. And I think on a certain level, that's the hobby, because we're always watching and taking in stimuli and taking in things that you might refer to in a film later, in the next week, next year, in 10 years, who knows? But they go into your conscious, your subconscious, and they remain as things that can be drawn on later. And I think that, to a great extent, is a full-time hobby as well. Well, there are several challenges involved. Naturally, you know, without any context, I speak in generality here, but you know, you've got to analyze the action. You know, you work closely with the director, and maybe there's a second unit director or a stunt director, stunt coordinator. All of those departments need to come together and meet and analyze precisely what it is you're going to do. If it's very involved, there will be storyboards or maybe pre-visualization, some sort of blueprint that you must follow. And then the mechanics of it. How detailed are we going to need special equipment? What sort of cameras, big, small, mobile, moving, static, high, low, all of those things have to be decided. And once all of that is planned out ahead, it becomes easier because you've taken the giant picture and broken it down into its smallest components. And then it's just a matter of ticking them off the list. You know, how do we shoot this? We've got that next. And you bring everything together. It can be fun. It can be challenging. It can be exciting because sometimes there are very intricate and dangerous stunts that have to be staged properly and safely. There's a lot more to it than meets the eye. When people see it on screen, it's all done and it's all polished and everything looks like it just fell out of the truck like that, which is completely not true, as we know. But it's attention to detail, I would say, more than anything. Attention to detail. You've got to consider every aspect of what you're doing, with safety certainly at the highest priority. But then it becomes a matter of mechanics and planning. Well, I want to continue working and improving, doing better work all the time. I always feel that the last thing that I've done is the best thing that I will ever do. And I want to continue to feel that way. You know, Conrad Hall, one of our great cinematographers, always used to say when he started a new production, it was always as if he had never done it before. And he's starting from scratch and learning all over again. And I believe that very much in my heart. I want to keep improving, working with talented people on bigger, better projects, and just growing and getting better at what I do, and helping to pass it along as well to other people, to young people coming up, young cinematographers and students and aspiring cinematographers. I spend a lot of time teaching and trying to pass some of that knowledge along. So the more that I do and the better I do it, is the more I want to pass it along to other people as well. Yes, well, I was president of the ASC, American Society of Cinematographers, for 6 years, two blocks of 3 years separated by 10 years. And it's wonderful. That experience was absolutely wonderful. The ASC is a terrific organization. Talking about education, education is a huge part of the ASC's mission. And the membership is obviously all cinematographers and people associated with cinematography. So you're surrounded by people who are just as passionate about what I do as I am. And it's a great entree into a very unique world. It gives you a lot of access to information and resources and people and facilities that you might not be able to access in any other way. It's a real opportunity for growth as a cinematographer and also as a person. We've made some great, great friends through the ASC. The Motion Picture Academy, Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, that hand out the Oscars every year. I was a governor of the Academy for 3 years, and that was a great experience too, but on a broader level, where you have all of the crafts, producing, directing, everything else down the line, in addition to cinematography, together, working to further the interests of the industry at large. So on the ASC side, it was really the macro, you know, narrow it in just to concern cinematography, while the Academy was the much broader community of filmmakers, not just in the US now, but around the world. And both experiences were just absolutely wonderful. I was very honored to be a part of both organizations in those capacities. You know, that's a tough question because my taste is so broad and I like so many different types of things that I can't really narrow it down to one factor in particular, or even a couple of factors. You know, it's almost cliche for a cinematographer to say, but it's a cliche for a good reason. But my favorite, probably my top films of all time, would be The Godfather and The Godfather Part Two. Photographically, they're just virtuoso performances by Gordon Willis, but there are so many others as well, and different genre, different approaches. I like so much of everything that I think it also ultimately comes down again to this intangible feeling. You know, something just touches you within for reasons that you're not even aware of, but you just know that it's substantial and it is actually working. It's having an effect on you. And sometimes it just comes entirely out of left field, where you go see something that you didn't have any expectation or any clue leading in. And then suddenly you're just blown away by what you see for whatever reason, whether it's the imagery, the theme, acting, it could be anything. I'm very lucky that I can watch something and detach from my cinematographer brain and just appreciate it as a film and not just sit there and analyze everything. Oh, where's that light coming from? Why did they do that? What lens is this? I can really easily detach from that and just enjoy it as a viewer. So I find myself continually being just moved by things that I see from everywhere. Just amazing. And I'm very thankful for that. It's a wonderful feeling to have, a wonderful sensitivity to have, I think. It really broadens you as a person, I think.
Wow.